There's really only one thing that you need to know when you're analyzing structures, and it is... Now, seriously, I will get to it shortly, but it does cover every aspect of analysis, whether you're doing slab design, beam design, column design, composite decks, those local connection designs, and even just local transfers. And the simplicity will make you realize how elegant and efficient you can make designs by just following this one rule. This one mechanical aspect is the fact that load always travels to the stiffest path first. And that's all it is.
Oh, really?
Doesn't matter whether it's a beam, column, or wall. This is because it's embedded in the way structural mechanics behave. So the load will travel along that route until that route either breaks or becomes softer. Now, breaking the element, that's pretty easy to understand. The load tries to go along it, the element can't resist it, it breaks, it finds a new path. Well, becoming softer, what does that actually mean? Now, it all stems from Newton's third law, that every reaction has an equal and opposite reaction. Linking back to that structural mechanics. The fact that any structural element to take load needs to have an equal and opposite reaction. So for a beam or slab to take the load back to the supports, it needs to deflect. And if we bring back to that beam analogy, just say we've got multiple beams lined up, and for whatever reason, the stiffest form over, that doesn't allow it to deflect. We push down on it, the load will share between those beams. Now, if those beams are of varying stiffness, it's all about the deflection that's going on upon it. The load will go onto the beams and share it between the stiffnesses of each of those beams. So the stiffest beam that needs the most force for it to deflect will take the biggest load, and the softest beam will take the least. Now, if we're moving up a little bit more onto this analogy, just say we've got beams and we've separated them with floor joists. The load applies down upon it, the floor joist deflects. The deflection of that floor joist helps spread the load between the different elements in the structure. So, of course, that one in the middle, which can take the biggest load because of the balancing force of the beam, will have the highest load because the deflection from both the beam and the floor joist is forcing the load to go there. Where the outer beams, which have a softer connection because of the way they're loaded up from the floor joist, will take least load. But it's a combination of both the beam stiffness and the floor joist stiffness, depending on the load spread between the three elements. So if we're going into something even a little bit more complex, we start to look at the behavior of slabs and how two-way actions work. So if we're looking at the way the load spread is, a really good analogy is yield line. So we have a series of columns on a floor plate. How is the load going to spread between them? The easiest way is going to be which is going to be the shortest path for the least deflection. And there's an easy way by using yield line. So yield line takes 45 degree angles from each of the supports until they make a crossing point. At which point, then we'll draw the straight line until we get to the other end. So we have a combination of triangles and really rectangles. The triangle area is where the slab is behaving in two ways. The stiffest path is for that load to go down towards the column strip, which is between the columns, and back towards the column. And likewise on the other end, it goes down towards the column strip that's along the bottom and back there. But in the middle, where I've got the straight line, the slab is really behaving one way, as it's only going up and down, similar to a one-way slab. So we can see where we've got two-way action and where we've got one-way by this simple methodology. Now, this can be even expanded further. Quite often when you're looking at load rundowns and tributary area on columns, you just draw pure rectangles. However, load doesn't really flow that way. It's always going to the shortest path possible. And quite often our columns are not in a symmetrical grid, which would form those rectangular load distributions. They're normally quite random, as they need to be in walls or where their other elements are. So when we're looking at circles and just drawing rectangles about the load paths, we can either be over or underestimating the loads on these areas. So we're applying back to that stiffest path first, it means that the load needs to travel the shortest distance to get towards those columns. And this is where we start to look at Voronoi diagrams. Now, basically what a Voronoi diagram is, it looks at each of those column grids and starts to draw a circle progressively bigger from each of them. And when it intersects with one of the other circles, it's when it starts to draw a line. So you can see by drawing lots of Voronoi shapes from those random column grids, you can get to quite unique tributary areas that are loaded on each of those columns. And it's all about the stiffest path first. But what even complicates it even further is the fact that the columns themselves need to shorten to take load. And this is called elastic shortening, or PL on EA if you need to calculate it. So P is the force that's applied to the column, L is it's either length or height, E is its Young's modulus, and A is the area. So if we combine both the stiffness of the slab and the softness of the columns, we can have a slightly variation of where that load's going. So for example, if you're surrounded by stiff columns with one soft column in the middle, The stiffer columns around the outer edge will take more load than that central softer column. So this is quite critical when you're looking at load distributions and where they're going, especially around walls. Columns are typically more highly stressed as they're a single element, where a wall is normally a longer element and it gets from that same applied load, it will deflect less. As it deflects less, it's more likely to attract greater loads on top of it. So we also need to be careful when we're distributing forces that we're not creating great differentials. And sometimes we need to balance the forces between the columns that are adjacent walls. Now that we've covered some basics of the gravity forces and how this applies in these areas, how about lateral stability? Surely it's different. Well, it's not really any different. Just the load is coming from a different direction. When we think about a slab, we do simplify it back into a strut and tie terms where we've got feeders and collectors to try and transfer the load back to the cores. Sometimes people may argue that we can create any form of diagrams. It doesn't really matter how we form that up, provided there is some load path there. However, there is going to be a more efficient path, and it's always going towards that stiffest direction. So you need to look at which is going to be the stiffest, shortest path for the load to get back to the elements that you're looking at. Yes, you could form up any diagram, and maybe it might work. However, have you had to break the other one that is stiffer for this load path to exist? And if that load path is broken, has it still allowed you to form the load path that you've come up with? If you don't really know where it's going and you've got lots of elements on the floor that make up where the force needs to go, you can throw it into an FEA software and apply a load and look at where your tension and compression forces are applying to the structure. And you'll see it'll be forming more of a flexural action. But before you just go and grab that FEA software and go, I know the answer, I'm going to go straight towards it, make a guess of where you think the loads are going to go and approximate, and over time you'll get better and you'll more understand structural mechanics. It's all about improving your knowledge. And this nicely brings me into the sponsor of this video, Skillshare. Skillshare has an amazing online community where you can help improve your knowledge to become that lifelong learner that every engineer needs to be. And if you're just looking to upskill your career development and looking for that next role, I wouldn't go any further than trying to improve your communication skills. It's one of the biggest and most important skill set that you have. And you'll find many courses that will help you improve your communication skills, whether they be written or verbal. The benefits of Skillshare that it is ad-free, so you can always stay up to date with new premium content coming out weekly. So there's always something new and better to discover. It also has an amazing subset of courses into Python programming, which is one of the second most important skills that I find that will help you improve your designs and speed up your efficiency. I've got a link in the below description where the first 1,000 subscribers will get 1 free month on Skillshare. I hope to see you there. Getting back to load paths and how the loads transfer in a lateral sense, there's also confusion about which elements are going to take which load, as you may have multiple elements in your structure. So you may have a shear wall here, core wall over here, or just bracing frames in certain locations. The load distribution is all about that stiffest path first. So just say they're all in the same location, pushing in the same direction. The load should be based on how much each element deflects and how much force it requires. So we've got the lateral force over here that's trying to push against the structure. And it's a balancing about how much each element will take so that the sum of the element deflections over here is the same, but it also equals that lateral force. And that's how it distributes the load. Now there's a little bit more complexity here, as sometimes the slab will deflect. You may have rotations, so elements that are further out may better resist more load because they will deflect relatively less based on that rotation. So the slab, when it's transferring the loads, does need to elastically shorten. So to some extent, elements that are further away may take slightly less load as there's some elastic shortening occurring before the load actually gets there. Well, how about big transfer structures? So we've got a big long wall, multiple point loads on the top, coming down to two supports. Now, when you look at it, it may be quite simple. You're just drawing a strut and tie diagram all the way up to the top. Then you've got a little tie at the bottom due to the size of those angles. It's not quite that simple. Because when we're looking at structural mechanics and how the behavior of this wall actually occur, the load will spread. So if the load can spread, it will. And the spreading of that load will be roughly at 45 degrees. As the load from the top wants to spread down and get to equilibrium in the wall, so you've got an even stress roughly along the whole length of that wall, until which point it will come down to the bottom and spread back out to those two supports. So your tension ties, if you did that really big long strut, may have been a little bit conservative, so you may need a little bit more load in there. So something you may have also been missing, so we've got the tension tie at the bottom, which is quite obvious from the strut and tie. But the load is also spreading at the top, so potentially there's also a tension tie at the top for the load to spread out to get to equilibrium. So if you're just thinking about a simple strut and tie, you may have missed that tie at the top. As we're saying, the load's diverging, there's a tension tie developed from the divergence of that load. So not only does the load diverge out, causing a tension tie at the top, but that divergence is also causing a spreading action that needs to be resisted in the wall. That's calculating that bottling action and how much force we need to resist it as it's spreading out. This divergence of load is also why you see local failures from bearing. As we're saying that load always needs to diverge, so the load comes down onto an element and is trying to diverge out to come to that equilibrium point. And this is why you get local failures in bearing just below the surface as the load comes down and is trying to diverge out, you get potentially local splitting failures. And this is what a bearing failure will be. If you're looking to progress your career faster in structural engineering, I'll give a link to my 10 top essential skills that you need to have to progress your career in structural engineering. And if you wish to support the channel, I've got links in the below description to my Patreon page. And I'd just like to give a quick shout out to one of my newest Patreons, Mark O'Hagan. Sorry if I butchered your name. Without your support and the support of my other patrons, this type of content won't be possible. And as always, stay safe, keep learning, and I'll see you next week. Bye.